Extant or Audio, a division of recorded books, presents The Burgundians, a Vanished Empire, a history of 1,111 years and one day, by Bart van Loo, translated by Nancy Forrest Flyer, narrated by Nigel Patterson. Genealogies and Royal Houses. The Royal Lineage of the Burgundians. Gebika. Mythical tribal king, who, with his son Gundahar, united the various Burgundian kings under him, died 407. Gundahar, king from 407 to 436, died in a battle with the Huns. Gundioch, 437 to 74, contemporary of Attila, who ruled from 434 to 454. Chilperic, 474 to 80. Gundobad, 480 to 516, ruled for a time with his brother Godegisel, whom he murdered, and later with his son Sigismund, contemporary of Clovis. Sigismund, 516 to 23. Gundomar, 523 to 34. According to Burgundian tradition, power was passed on to the next generation only when the last representative of the previous generation died. Sometimes brothers would reign together for a few years, which often led to fatal conflicts, as with Gundobad and Godegisel. Strictly speaking, there were two kingdoms, with a discernible break between the slaughter by Aetius and the Huns in 436 on the one hand, and the subsequent flight from Worms to the south on the other. I chose to regard them as one kingdom, because in the end it was the same royal family that held sway, albeit over two different regions. It was from the southern region that the medieval and present-day Burgundy would develop. That white tablecloth with spots of grease, pure damask with burgundy stains, sticks to these fingers and slowly unfurls between two stanzas. Leonard Nolens, Ein Dichter in Antwerpen in andere Gedichten, A Poet in Antwerp and Other Poems, 2005. Prologue. They weren't exactly attractive. Their grey-green cloth covers looked dreary and dull. But once you opened the books, you found yourself in a world of excitement and adventure. By the time I was 14, I had read them to pieces. All six volumes of Slans Chlori, 1949-61, along with Thea Beckman's famous fictional trilogy on the Hundred Years' War, they were my open sesame in 1987. The gateway to big history had been thrown open wide. Slans Chlori was the first work issued by the Historia Publishing Company. The idea was to cut out coupons that were printed on the packages of various food products. You then exchanged the coupons for little colour prints, each with a brief commentary on the back, so by eating the right products, you could also acquire knowledge. You pasted the pictures into the green albums provided for this purpose. We weren't the only ones with such albums on our bookshelves. Two, maybe three generations of Belgians grew up with them. Their impact cannot be underestimated. The author of the commentaries, Professor Jean Schonians, was not one to avoid clichés. In his terse summaries, he spoke of hale and hearty soldiers, called a lady dressed as a nun a cunning lady of the nobility, and criticised the fearsome Duke of Alva. He viewed the past through a romantic filter and roused a sense of pride in us. It was no accident that the word Chlori appeared in the title. The spirit of the 19th century swept through every page. Schonians was a dyed-in-the-wool Belgian nationalist, and in his uncompromising reading of history, it was as if our country had always existed, as if the native population had been fully aware of their identity 2,000 years ago. Didn't I learn from his books that in 57 BC the Belgians were a happy people? But then came the Romans. That was on page 9, and I was already on the edge of my seat. Not long afterwards, Schonians claimed that the Belgians played a decisive role in the conquering of Jerusalem. I was so agitated that I even set Thea Beckmann's novels aside. Forsaking her for the pedantic writings of Schonians is hard to explain, but Slan's glory had another ace up its sleeve. What made the series not only attractive but also unforgettable were the illustrations by Jean-Léon Huance. He often turned to the old masters for inspiration. I saw my first Van Eyck and Van der Weyden through his eyes. But he was just as happy to employ his own ideas. He tried out unexpected perspectives, played with surprising frames, and painted the faces of the dying. His realistic style is firmly embedded in my memory. If someone happens to mention Charles Martel, Godfrey of Bouillon, or William of Orange, their visages appear in my mind just as he once depicted them. The pinnacle of his skill could be seen on page 15 of volume 3, identified as illustration number 182, Nancy. Usually, Huance served up some striking portrait, gripping scene, or detail from a battle. But this time, his illustration was conspicuous for its apparent emptiness. Every time I see this picture, I'm 14 again. I see that winter landscape just as I saw it back then. A tree, a snow-covered expanse, two armed men approaching in the distance. I was astonished by the bareness of that mainly snow-white illustration. The tree and the men were marginal details. Out of curiosity, I read Schonian's commentary. In 1477, Charles the Bold laid siege to the city of Nancy. He met his death in battle, the circumstances of which remain unclear. His body was found beneath the snow, half devoured by wolves. I looked again at the illustration, and only then did I see the dark outline barely visible in the shadow of the tree. You could just make out the contours of a dead body. My eyes jumped from text to picture and back again, and the same questions cropped up. Who was Charles the Bold? Why was he given that name? What in the world happened to him in Nancy? And what about those wolves? No matter how much I was dragged along by the further course of the history, I kept coming back to this illustration, to the wolves, the snow, the body, to the mystery of Nancy. It would take 30 years for me to figure it all out. The tragic demise of Charles the Bold, Duke of Burgundy, became an important element in this book, in which I search not only for the facts surrounding this anecdote, but also for what Huance and Schonians tried to dredge up in their own way in Slan's glory. The origin of our whole region. And by that, I do not mean Belgium, for despite Schonian's good intentions, it was the Low Countries that emerged first, only later to be followed by Belgium and the Netherlands. Finally, in 1987, I resumed my reading of Thea Beckmann. After Geef me ruimte, Give Me Room, 1976, came Triumph van de Verschroide Aarde, Triumph of the Scorched Earth, 1977, and Het Rad van Fortuin, The Wheel of Fortune, 1978. Countless Belgian and Dutch readers were gripped by the adventures of Maria, alias Marie Claire, and her son Matisse. I regard their ordeals during the Hundred Years' War as my first great reading experience. This was the real thing, reading great books that breathe new life into age-old events, getting inside someone else's skin, trembling with emotion and suspense, and learning something at the same time. Beckmann's trilogy covered the years 1346 to 69. She introduced characters who would haunt me for years to come. Bertrand du Guesclin, John the Good, the Black Prince, Charles V, Étienne Marcel. Not to mention the settings, the battles of Crécy and Poitiers, the cities of Paris and Bruges in the 14th century. They all appear in the book you now hold in your hands. The period between the time depicted in her trilogy and the death of Charles the Bold constitutes its beating heart. Some reading experiences are so powerful that they continue to ferment for decades. One day I could no longer resist the temptation, and I stepped into the breach that Beckmann's trilogy and Uance's illustration number 182 had opened in my imagination. Like the world around us, we ourselves are the fruit of the past. I spent years peeking over the wall, and my eyes were invariably drawn to the south, to France, about which I've written several books. Feasting on that culture has made me who I am today. Only much later did I realise that in all that time my feet had never strayed far from home. First in the sandy soil of the Campine, then in the streets of Antwerp, and finally in the clay of West Flanders, and, due to my increasingly frequent travels to the north, the polders of Holland. Suddenly my eyes abandoned the southern horizon and began looking down. The place occupied by my own feet began to intrigue me. How could I have been so neglectful of my roots for all those years? Our historiography is full of book-length works explaining how the Low Countries broke up at the end of the 16th century, dividing the northern Netherlands from the southern Netherlands, and ultimately the Netherlands of today from Belgium. Historical research has paid so much attention to that painful division of property that we seldom ask ourselves what it had been like before the divorce, as if we had never been together at all. I began to read and travel through time, to Dijon, Paris, Lille, Bruges, Ghent, Brussels, Mechelen, Delft, Gouda, Nijmegen and Sertogenbosch. I saw blossoming cities, incipient individualism and dying chivalric ideals, schizophrenic kings, aggressive dukes and brilliant artists, pyres and banquets, plague and jousting, Joan of Arc, Philip the Good, and the Order of the Golden Fleece. This long search led me to the emergence of the Low Countries in the 15th century. And what did I learn? That the Low Countries are a Burgundian invention. Naturally, the geographical fact of the Lachen Landen Bieder See, lowlands by the sea, as an anonymous monk once put it, had existed for years, but the inhabitants of the principalities located there lived independent of each other for the most part. In feudal terms, they belonged either to the Kingdom of France or to the Holy Roman Empire. Yet in the late Middle Ages, a number of these domains merged, and, wedged as they were between these two great powers, a new entity was born. The Burgundian dukes Philip the Bold, John the Fearless, Philip the Good, and Charles the Bold, who met his end at Nancy, played a leading role in this process and emerged as the founding fathers of the unified Netherlands. Philip the Bold laid the foundation, his descendants built on his legacy, and under the authority of his grandson, Philip the Good, the united lands on the lower reaches of the Rhine, the Meuse, and the Scheldt would acquire a political dimension for the first time. These events certainly constitute the forgotten genesis of the Low Countries. But with the intense interconnectedness of those regions with France, England, the Holy Roman Empire, and finally Spain, it's not too much of a stretch to also see them as European history of the highest order. Burgundy was the principal actor in history's last great crusade. It played a key role at the end of the Hundred Years' War, and was instrumental in the growing European power of the Habsburgs. It all started when Philip the Bold, as Duke of Burgundy, married Margaret of Mahle, the daughter of the Flemish Count. Their marriage in Ghent on the 19th of June 1369 seemed like the ideal opening for this book. The only problem was that after three pages, I found I needed 15 footnotes to keep from needlessly weighing down my text by identifying someone like Louis of Mahle or explaining a concept like feudalism. In short, I needed to back up a bit to keep the story from buckling under the weight of information that I could not assume every listener might have at hand. Beginning half a century earlier might do the trick. Not far enough, as it turned out. 100 years, then. Eventually, I cast my line almost a millennium earlier. My thinking went something like this. What if I were to begin the great story of the Middle Ages from the standpoint of the ancient Burgundians, the Germanic peoples who first appeared in the pages of history in 406, the royal predecessors of the dukes of the 14th and 15th centuries? It proved quite a challenge to find an alternative means of resurrecting an era that, for the most part, has been shrouded in mystery. But it was worth the effort. Not only did the ancient warriors point the way to a great many key historic moments, but they also solved the problem I was facing. Now the listener would embark on the Burgundian journey with the proper luggage. While the first part of the book spans almost 1,000 years, 406 to 1369, the next part comprises a century, 1369 to 1467. The third part covers a decade, 1467 to 77, while parts 4 and 5 deal with exactly a year, 1482, and a day. The shape of the book is that of an inverted pyramid. It starts by spreading its wings and flying with rapid strokes high over the Middle Ages. Then it takes its time to observe events from a closer range. As its focus sharpens, it heads slowly but surely towards a carefully chosen destination. A forgotten day in Leer, a small city in the former Duchy of Brabant, where on the 20th of October 1496, Western history took a sharp turn. 10 years ago, as if to thank me for services rendered, France sent one of its women my way, something no Légion d'honneur can top. She turned out to be a descendant of a Burgundian family and had spent her youth in the old duchy. Exactly 647 years after the wedding of Philip the Bold and Margaret of Mala, we celebrated our Flemish Burgundian nuptials. The dowry was less impressive, nor could our reception hold a candle to the lavish banquets of the Burgundian dukes. But the actual decision to get married occurred at approximately the same time as the plan to chronicle the historic bond between Burgundy and the Low Countries. My wife had to admit that, despite her origins, she knew little or nothing about the dukes, let alone Burgundy's connection with my native region. Burgundy has always been regarded as a poor relation in the history of France. Anyone who knows the story will understand why. Our little daughter followed this entire process from close range. She was raised with an ear for both French and Dutch, and now she crosses the language border dozens of times a day without being aware of it. She also makes the actual journey to the south a couple of times a year, to the Burgundian motherland, to be exact. I decided to tell her about my new book by degrees. Could it be that I wrote it mainly for her? Wasn't she a French-Belgian child? Flemish-Burgundian? In short, the ideal reader of this book in progress? After my last book, she became quite skilled at chanting the names of all the Napoleonic campaigns, and now she's surprising museum visitors. On a recent trip to the Musée des Beaux-Arts, Museum of Fine Arts in Dijon, I showed her the portrait of a man dressed in black, his gaze clear, with a black chaperone on his head and the chain of the Order of the Golden Fleece round his neck. When I asked her on the spur of the moment if she knew who this fellow was, the little girl, not yet 4 years old, promptly answered, "Philip the Good." At least there's one person who will recognise the man on the cover of my book, I thought. The most beautifully preserved portrait of the real founding father of the Low Countries, after a lost original by Rogier van der Weyden. While the dukes engaged in battles, entered into marriages, and introduced reforms in order to forge a single entity from those fragmented lands, the unforgettable works by Klaus Schlüter, Jan van Eyck, Rogier van der Weyden, and Hugo van der Hoos were created under their impulse. Telling the story of the Burgundians is like opening a treasure chest full of masterpieces. During the writing process, I realised I had no choice but to include large sections of French history as well. After all, Philip the Bold was the first of the four dukes, the youngest son of the French King John the Good, brother of Charles V and regent of the young Charles VI. and during the Hundred Years' War, he planned the most spectacular French-Burgundian invasion of England ever. The tension between France and Burgundy, and later the Burgundian Netherlands, inevitably became a recurring theme in the narrative. I have to admit that things didn't go quite as expected. In order to tell the story of the Low Countries properly, I would have to begin with what I had wanted to avoid all along, peeking over that wall. My gaze was once again drawn southward towards France. Only gradually did my story make its way to the north. That happened step by step, little by little, a process that perfectly reflected the evolution that I myself had gone through. The roots of the Low Countries run underground to the south. I never would have expected it, but my southward gaze and northern roots were destined to intersect. Bart van Loo, Druy-Parigny, Burgundy, summer 2015, Morsela, Flanders, autumn 2018. Part 1. To us in olden story are wonders many told, of heroes rich in glory, of trials manifold, of joy and festive greeting, of weeping and of woe, of keenest warriors meeting, shall ye now many a wonder know. Anonymous, The Nibelungen Lied, circa 1200. The Forgotten Millennium, 406 to 1369. Or how you can take a fresh look at the first 1,000 years of the Middle Ages from the perspective of the Burgundians, and how these Romanized Germanic tribes always seem to have been on the front line at great events such as the migration of peoples, the fall of the Western Roman Empire, the emergence of Christianity, the invasion of the barbarians from the north and heretics from the south, the golden age of the great monastic orders, and the Hundred Years' War between England and France. In short, long before they emerged as the founding fathers of the Low Countries, thanks to Philip the Bold, John the Fearless, and Philip the Good, the Burgundians had already left their mark on key moments in European history. From Kingdom to Duchy, or how the Romans, Huns, Germans, Moors, and Vikings jostled one another on the way to an uncertain future, and how Burgundy came into being. In the last month of the year of our Lord 406, temperatures dropped to well below freezing. It was so cold that during the Christmas holidays the Rhine froze solid in the area around the city of Mainz. The seemingly untraversable river, the heavily guarded border between Gaul, administered by the Romans, and the obscure Germania, where countless tribes were always at each other's throats, turned into a big and inviting bridge. Vandals, Suebi, and Alans wasted no time and soon overran Gaul. Of course, there's no such thing as a watertight border. Just imagining it was an exercise in futility. No matter how much effort the Romans put into guarding the Rhine, the Danube, and the fortified wall defences between them during the first centuries of the Common Era, border traffic had always been heavy, and the main purpose of the so-called limes was to keep the numerous passages under control. Some Germanic tribes were even given permission by Rome to settle in the border region, forming a sort of human buffer zone. Thus the Salian Franks fanned out between the Meuse and the Scheldt and held sway in large parts of what are today the Netherlands and Flanders. As the centuries passed, migration pressure intensified. Both the prosperity on the other side of the border and their own growing population made the Germanic tribes in the northeast and the Goths in the east increasingly eager to trek westward. The second and third centuries had seen a great many waves of migrants, but by the end of the fourth and the beginning of the fifth, there was no stopping them. When the Huns from the steppes of Central Asia commenced their rampage, they drove numerous Germanic tribes from their homelands, and these groups subsequently propelled each other westward, fighting all the way. The Romans refused to grant asylum to this swarm, but before they knew what was happening to them, a vast conglomeration of tribes was sweeping over them like a tornado. By the end of 406, the Germans were forced to break through the borders. The inundated Romans struggled against them for 70 more years, when they were finally swallowed up for good. In this story of the Great Migration, as epic as it is complex, the Burgundians are often ignored altogether, or mentioned in passing at the very most, if not whisked away in a footnote. Everyone knows their famous contemporaries Clovis and Attila, the Franks and the Huns, but who has ever heard of the Burgundians in this context? Yet this forgotten Germanic tribe also crossed the Rhine in 406-7 and made their contribution as a small cog in setting the gigantic wheel of time in motion and causing antiquity to tip into the Middle Ages. When the Burgundians settled in the area of Worms after their crossing, they had centuries of wanderings behind them. If you reverse that journey and go further and further east, you end up in their ancestral homeland. Before Worms, they had lived in the Mainz region. A century before that, they populated the middle course of the Elbe, where they ended up after a sojourn near the Oder. And before that, in the 1st century AD, they lived on the banks of the Wisła in today's Poland. Rivers tell the story of peoples. The Wisła empties into the Baltic Sea and points the way to their first home, the small island of Bornholm that lies in the Baltic Sea between Poland and Sweden, 150 kilometres east of Denmark, of which it is now a part. At that time, the old Norwegians called the island Burgundarholmer, which was echoed in the name the Burgundians claimed for themselves and smuggled all through Europe, across the Wisła, the Oder, the Elbe, and finally the Rhine. They made their way valiantly, but did not come out of the long journey unscathed. They fought numerous battles that have gone practically unnoticed and lost many of them, especially against the Alemanni, resulting in a steady decrease in their numbers. In 406-7, King Gundahar led approximately 80,000 Burgundians to the region around Worms. It is not clear whether this number refers to his soldiers alone or to the entire population. In exchange for guarding the border, the Romans gave him permission to establish a kingdom along the Rhine. But that was not enough for this ambitious monarch. In 435, he moved westward to Gallia Belgica, the area between the Rhineland and the Seine that would later lend its name to Belgium, in order to increase the size of his territory. Such audacity cost Gundahar dearly. In 436, with a mercenary army consisting of Huns under the command of a certain Attila, the Roman supreme commander, Flavius Aetius, crushed the Burgundians in a bloody battle. Most of Gundahar's family were massacred. Only his son Gundioch managed to escape. Gundioch led what remained of his people to the south and saved the Burgundian royal house from extinction. The massacre must have been so overwhelming that it inspired Burgundian poets to create epic stories, which were passed on and embellished. Over the course of the centuries, they would fuse into the German epic poem the Nibelungenlied, in which Gundahar appears as Gunther. The name of King Etzel could be seen as a nod to the Roman Aetius, but it probably refers to Attila. Whatever the case may be, Richard Wagner owed the inspiration for his operatic trilogy to a devastating defeat suffered by the Burgundians in the 5th century, and more specifically, to their aborted desire to conquer what later became Belgium. The fate of Western civilization is hanging by a thread. In 436, Attila had happily accepted payment from the Romans to teach the Burgundians a lesson. But in 447, he destroyed that lucrative alliance and made his way through Gallia Belgica, plundering and pillaging as he went. Although there's little to substantiate Attila's boast that the grass no longer grew wherever his horse left its hoofprint, his violent raids did inspire the Romans to undertake their last spectacular military operation in Western Europe. Unless they stopped Attila, Gaul would soon belong to the vast barbarian empire that stretched from the Rhine to the Caucasus and had initially been governed from present-day Hungary. On the 20th of June 451, two motley armies crossed swords on the Catalanian plains near Troyes, in the northeast of today's France. On one side were the Huns and all the tribes they had managed to scrape together on their path of destruction. On the other was a bloc that the Romans had formed with Gallic and Germanic forces. The menacing horde from Central Asia against the Western allies, the scourge of God from the East against the most important man in the Western Roman Empire, Attila versus Aetius. The composition of the armies says a great deal about the fragmentation that the various European migrations had brought about. The Huns themselves formed only a part of Attila's army, which consisted of Ostrogoths, Gepids, Thuringii, and Rugii. Fighting on the other side, along with the Romans and Burgundians, were Visigoths, Alans, and Salian Franks. Almost all the peoples who lived between the Atlantic Ocean and the Volga were present, and prepared to tear each other to shreds during the most important battle of late antiquity. According to the chroniclers, hundreds of thousands of warriors were involved, but modern estimates speak of around 60,000 troops, more or less evenly divided between the two camps. For the Burgundians, Attila's arrival in Gaul was a signal for revenge. Driven by memories of the good times in Worms and the nightmare of a bitter defeat, they oiled their weapons and saddled their horses. Some of the older warriors among them had been present at the disastrous battle 15 years earlier, and the youngest soldiers had replayed that defeat in their childhood games. Now the opportunity to get justice done was being handed to them on a silver platter. The fact that the Burgundians had been invited to join the fray by Aetius, of all people, the commander who had unleashed the Huns on them in 436, didn't seem to bother them. After a few skirmishes, Aetius was able to take the high ground, enabling him to survey the Catalonian plains. Attila instructed his priests and diviners to hurriedly predict the battle's outcome. After examining the shoulder blades of the sheep they had sacrificed, the priests announced that things looked far from rosy. The Hunnish leader saw only one way out. Offense was the best defense. "I myself will throw the first javelin, and the wretch who refuses to imitate the example of his sovereign is devoted to inevitable death." Archers exchanged volleys for a short time, until suddenly the fearsome cavalry of the Huns made a great charge. These horsemen could twist their upper bodies while astride their galloping horses, in order to attack their pursuers with bow and arrow. They opened a breach in the centre of Aetius's army. Theodoric, the king of the Visigoths, was killed in the chaos and then trampled by his own troops. In the face of total confusion and the danger of flight, Theodoric's son Thorismund drew his sword, set his father's crown on his head, and drove the Huns back. Franks, Burgundians, and Romans came to his aid, and Attila was forced to take cover behind an improvised fortress of saddles and wagons. The allies' advance was brought to a halt only by the coming of night. Attila could not imagine himself leaving the field of battle alive. He set fire to his defensive enclosure and calmly prepared himself for death. During the allies' fatal final assault, he planned to cast himself into the flames as a martyr and thus avoid the humiliation of imprisonment. With that thought in mind, he went to sleep. But the dreaded attack never materialized. Supreme Commander Aetius put all his powers of persuasion on the line to convince his troops to let the Huns escape. With the skill of a master chess player, he had succeeded in getting all the tribes to join him, while realizing that soon he would have to lock horns with them in a contest for the leadership of Gaul. The external threat of the Huns could come in very useful. The power of the Visigoths in particular was a thorn in his side. They occupied not only southwestern Gaul, but also part of the Iberian Peninsula, so he was glad to trick Thorismund into returning home. He fooled Thorismund into thinking that his brothers had seized the throne in their capital city of Toulouse, now that their father Theodoric had perished. With the departure of the Visigoths, the great army was deprived of its most effective force, and there were too few troops left to deal a death blow to the Huns. With his tactical cunning, Aetius had denied the Burgundians the chance to retaliate for all the pain they had suffered, but he would soon richly reward them. When dawn broke, Attila was utterly astonished to see a practically empty plain stretched out before him. He quickly got over his astonishment, as well as his heroic suicidal intentions, and fled across the Rhine. Seeking revenge, he turned his attention to Rome. That campaign fizzled as well, although it did have important consequences. When the inhabitants of northeastern Italy heard that Attila was on the march, they panicked and took cover on the islands in the lagoon of the Adriatic Sea. This precarious refuge would one day become Venice, the largest metropolis of the New Age after Paris. Attila was not the bloodthirsty tyrant legend makes him out to be. He was too clever and diplomatic for that. Nor was he the brilliant warrior that countless books have asserted. The meagre results of his Western campaign of conquest give the lie to that claim. He did emerge as an exceptional leader who managed to forge one big empire out of the chaotic diversity of Hunnic tribes, who forced the great power blocks of his age to face him down in one powerful alliance. But mainly, he was the quintessential barbarian of his time, and he achieved this status when the up-and-coming barbarians were beyond counting. Because of the terrifying aura that surrounds him when he appears in the various chronicles, his most important conquest was posthumous. He now occupies a blood-drenched place in our collective memory. The small but sturdily built Attila, as he has been traditionally described, met his end during his wedding feast in 453 under less than heroic circumstances. One chronicler described him getting blind drunk and choking on his own blood as a result of a copious nosebleed. Another cited his new wife Ildiko as his unexpected murderer. The claim that the fate of Western civilization was hanging by a thread on the 20th of June 451 is romantic hyperbole. The end of the Western Roman Empire had already been written in the stars for quite some time. All the Romans did on the Catalonian plains was to ensure that the new driving force of the West would not be the Huns but the Germans, fighting it out among themselves. The Franks, the Visigoths, or perhaps the Burgundians? In any case, halfway through the 5th century the Hunnish threat was defused for good, although Attila's ghost did come prowling round one last time a quarter of a century later. In 475, the successful politician Orestes manoeuvred his young son onto the Roman throne. This was only a diversionary tactic, for in fact the strong man in the capital was Orestes himself. When the Germanic Odoacer had the devious Orestes executed, and then deposed the weak Romulus Augustulus, literally Little Emperor, in 476, it meant the end of the moribund Western Roman Empire. The scourge of God must have had a good chuckle in the heathen hereafter. For this Orestes, who held in his hands the very last spark of Roman power, was none other than his former secretary. Attila could embrace eternity with a clear conscience. Rancid butter, an excess of onions and garlic. Let's let the dust settle on the turbulent 5th century and turn our eyes to the Burgundians. After the defeat of the Huns, Aetius assented to what in reality was already a fact. The region of Savoy, in today's France, with northern and southern offshoots, became the Burgundians' official territory. After a journey that took hundreds of years and covered thousands of kilometres, they found themselves nearing the endpoint of their adventurous trek, a hair's breadth from the French region that still bears their name. The Burgundians were almost home. In the preceding centuries, they had mixed so often with other tribes and adjusted so often to new climatological and geographical conditions that whether anything remained of their Scandinavian genes and customs is open to question. Scientists specialised in genography believe that based on recent research into human ancestry, the haplogroup Q, a particular group of genetically related individuals, occurs with greater frequency, above 4%, in certain regions of Scandinavia, including Bornholm, and in the French valleys of the Rhône and the Somme, with slight outliers running northward in the direction of Worms. Remarkably, this corresponds with the beginning and end points of the Burgundian wanderings. However, similar research establishes with equal validity that the Vandals, the Suebi, the Franks, and the Burgundians exchanged at least as many chromosomes as sword blows during their long journey towards Gaul. The genetic characteristics of the Germanic tribes that crossed the Rhine in the 5th century were acquired haphazardly for the most part, although it would appear that the story of the migrations can still be read to some extent in our genes. Do we have any idea what the ancient Burgundians looked like? Sidonius Apollinaris, who later became Bishop of Clermont, encountered the tribe for the first time in 466 and described them as long-haired giants more than 6 feet in height who speak an incomprehensible babble. On top of that, they smear their hair with rancid butter and their food stinks of an excess of onions and garlic. Quite colourful, to be sure, but this was essentially the kind of cliché that refined Gallo-Romans would apply to any barbarian. It says just as much about the observer as the observed. King Gundobad, son of Gundioc, profited from the disintegration of the Western Roman Empire and gradually expanded his kingdom, so that by the beginning of the 6th century it extended from Nevers to Basel and in the south as far as Avignon. Yet that paled in comparison with what his Germanic rivals managed to pull off in Europe, and in around 500 there was every indication that Gundobad was in danger of being crushed from both sides. The almighty Visigoths and the fierce and ever-advancing Franks were ready to eat the Burgundians alive. The challenge for Gundobad was not insignificant, but he proved himself a very capable administrator and politician. Not only did he manage to strengthen his international position, but a sense of Burgundian identity blossomed under his leadership. The latter in particular was quite a feat, given the fact that as Germans they were seriously outnumbered in their own kingdom, which was populated mostly by Gallo-Romans. The Celts had been living in Gaul since time immemorial. The Romans regarded them as a rather hot-tempered, macho people and mockingly called them Galli, roosters. In 52 BC, Julius Caesar put an end to the defiance of these Gauls by besieging Alesia for 6 weeks, after which the city surrendered and their leader Vercingetorix made a historic genuflection before the Roman commander. Caesar's triumph not only resulted in the birth of a mixed Gallo-Roman culture in the conquered areas, but it also gave him the self-confidence he needed to strive for supreme power in Rome. These events, the unfurling of Caesar's hubris and the official beginning of the Romanization of what would later become France, didn't happen just anywhere. Alesia lay in the region that soon would become known as Burgundy. Like the Celts, who had been conquered by Caesar in bygone days, the Burgundians and other Germanic peoples who arrived with them would let themselves be intoxicated by Roman culture. This was evident not only in their adoption of Roman dress and gastronomic preferences, but also in their tendency to soak their language and custom in a tub of Latinate herbs, of which the Lex Burgundionum 502, the statute book of King Gundobad, is a fine example. With this collection of laws, the Burgundians hoped to accommodate the local Gallo-Roman residents, who were now easily in the majority. Every trial had to be presided over by a Burgundian and a Gallo-Roman, and from then on the right of intermarriage was extended to both peoples. Germanic and Roman names were used interchangeably with greater frequency, and a new kind of aristocracy took shape, combining the large-scale land ownership of the Gallo-Romans with the militarism of the Burgundians, a forerunner of the feudal system. The incorporation of Germanic tribal customs into existing Roman law was rendered in Latin, interestingly enough. The Burgundians had already been living almost 60 years in Romanized territories, and most of them spoke East Germanic as well as Late Latin. Thanks to the Lex Burgundionum, the Gallo-Romans did become a bit Germanized, but what the statute book mainly showed was how a Germanic people dropped their own language in official documents and opted for full Romanization. Even during their Germanic period, the Burgundians had a special craving for the alcoholic drink for which they would become world famous over the course of the next millennium. As the new statute book stated, if anyone enters a vineyard at night or during the harvest period and is killed by the guard, the family of the victim has no recourse to complaint. The Romans had introduced viniculture, and the vines seemed to thrive on the so-called golden slopes, Côte d'Or. Some of the Germanic punishments must have surprised the local population. A man who had stolen a hunting dog was made to kiss the animal's backside in public. For stealing a falcon, the thief's head or chest would be covered with meat, after which the falcon would be released to satisfy its hunger. Clearly, the legal texts did not rule out a certain macabre wit. But they also show how much importance the Burgundians attached to their animals, especially those that were used in hunting, another fact that would stand the test of time. It was always possible to escape such ridiculous punishments by handing over a sum of money. First, you paid the amount that the animal or victim was worth, then a financial penalty for the violation itself. The Lex Burgundionum contains a carefully compiled list of rates. To name but a few, killing a dog, 1 solidus, a Roman coin from which the word soldier was derived, because that is how they were paid. Raping a woman, 12 solidi. Cutting off a woman's hair for no reason, 12 solidi. Murdering a slave, 30 solidi. Murdering a carpenter, 40 solidi. Murdering a blacksmith, 50 solidi. Murdering a silversmith, 100 solidi. Murdering a goldsmith, 200 solidi. Family honour was central to their culture, but in order to prevent clans from tearing each other apart in endless feuds, the Burgundians worked out an ingenious system. Those whose honour had been defiled could simply be bought off. If the guilty family refused to pay, however, there was only one way out, and that was the so-called faihitha, or bloody vendetta. The vendettas in which the royal family became entangled over the course of the 6th century escalated to such a degree that it led to the end of the kingdom. Gaul is certainly worth an icy bath. On the 25th of December 506, 100 years to the day since the Germanic tribes had crossed the Rhine, a 40-year-old Frankish king waded through a vessel of holy water. When Clovis reached the other side of the large baptismal font in the cathedral at Reims, he looked round and nodded humbly, the sign for 3,000 Frankish warriors to do the same. The splashing of the sacred waves caused an undulation that would continue for centuries to come. The baptism of Clovis caused the wheel of time to click one notch further, but what a notch it was! The kingdom of the Franks, which would lend its name to La Douce France, became the oldest daughter of the Church and would resolutely support Rome in the conquering of the West. Of course, this historic moment could never have taken place without the ruthless ambition of the Frankish king himself, but it was equally unthinkable without the persuasive powers of one particular Burgundian princess. There had been little indication that one day Clovis would ensnare the Catholic Clotilde in his nets. Legend has it that his grandfather Merovich, after whom the Frankish Merovingian dynasty was named, had fought on the side of the Burgundians against the Huns, but little was left of that band of brothers. More than a century earlier, the Salian Franks had been given permission to live in present-day Belgium on the condition that they join in defending the borders against invaders. This small kingdom north of Gaul failed to satisfy Clovis's ambitions, however, and from his capital of Tournai he felt the south beckon. In 500 he marched on Dijon in Burgundy, where King Gundobad and his brother Godegisel were waiting for him. The battle had just begun when Godegisel betrayed the Burgundian cause and defected to the Franks. Devastated, Gundobad fled to Avignon. Just as he was about to be overtaken by the enemy troops, they turned round and tore off to the north, having heard that the Visigoths, who controlled all of southwestern Gaul, were threatening their land. Gundobad took advantage of Clovis's departure by personally killing his brother Godegisel, drowning his sister-in-law in the Rhone, beheading their sons and throwing them into a deep well. He spared his two grandchildren because they were too young, an impulse of human kindness that would have fateful consequences. He then formed an alliance with Clovis in order to guarantee the safety of the kingdom. As part of the negotiations, he thought it would be a good idea to marry his niece Clotilde, the Catholic daughter of a deceased brother, to the Frankish king. And so it was that the two peoples who only recently had been at each other's throats were joined together in the bonds of matrimony in 501. At first, the pagan Clovis would have nothing to do with the Christian faith, no matter how hard his pious wife tried to convert him. Nevertheless, Clotilde had their first child baptized without her husband's permission. When the child died in its baptismal garment, Clovis ranted that it was all the fault of that foreign religion. His rage was rekindled when their second child also succumbed to illness after having been baptized. Nevertheless, in the chill of Christmas night in the year 506, he would immerse his long wavy locks, a Frankish sign of strength and regal dignity, in the holy water font. Just as the Huguenot Henry IV converted to Catholicism under the motto "Paris is well worth a mass" at the end of the 16th century, so Clovis might have thought, "Gaul is certainly worth an icy bath." In his hunger for power, the leader had understood that he could make good use of the up-and-coming Catholic Church. Another Constantine advanced to the baptismal font to terminate the disease of ancient leprosy and wash away with fresh water the foul spots that had long been born, wrote Gregory of Tours. Even though his Historia Francorum, History of the Franks, dates to the end of the 6th century, Gregory described events as if he had been there himself. Thus he noted Clovis's promise to the bishop: "The people who follow me cannot endure to abandon their gods, but I shall go and speak to them according to your words." Clearly, Gregory was summoning every ounce of his rhetorical talent to make sure that Clovis, and by extension all of Francia, the kingdom of the Franks, was absorbed into the history of Holy Rome. The reference to Constantine was not a gratuitous flourish. After the Holy Cross appeared to the Roman commander in 312, he ordered that every soldier's shield be adorned with this symbol. Constantine won the battle at the gates of Rome. Not only did he become the new emperor, but he also cleared the way for the Christianization of the Romans. What happened to Clovis was strikingly similar. A few months before his baptism, he had gone to war on the Tolbiac Plain near Cologne against the Alemanni, the Germanic tribal confederation that controlled the southern part of today's Germany and was advancing westward. The Frankish troops were taken by surprise, and when the appeal to Vaudan proved ineffective, Clovis, at his wit's end, was said to have cried out, "Jesus Christ, whom Clotilde asserts to be the Son of the living God, who art said to give aid to those in distress and to bestow victory on those who hope in thee, I beseech the glory of thy aid, with the vow that if thou wilt grant me victory over these enemies, and I shall know that power which she says the people dedicated in thy name have had from thee, I will believe in thee and be baptized in thy name." The god of his Burgundian spouse must have sensed an opportunity, for he did what was asked of him. The tide of the battle turned, and at the very last moment Clovis claimed victory. To show his gratitude to the benevolent Christian God, he solemnly swore that he would let himself be baptized. Of course, his conversion was a masterly example of realpolitik more than anything else, But in France's national narrative, this fable of insight and repentance, this story of Christian purification and divine intervention, sounded much better. It was hardly surprising when the Burgundian Clotilde was added to the growing list of saints almost immediately after her death, and that her intercession would henceforth be sought for the conversion of unbelieving spouses. Anyone who could prevail over the headstrong Clovis must have been cut from the right persuasive cloth. Interestingly enough, over the centuries, she also became the patron saint of notaries, paralytics, and light aircraft. The latter probably because the Frankish king crushed the Alemanni in Tolbiac, thanks to fire from the sky, according to Gregory of Tours. Legend has it that when Bishop Remigius, whose remains still lie in the abbey in Reims that is dedicated to him, discovered that he had forgotten to prepare the chrism on Christmas night of 506, a dove promptly flew in with a vial of oil. With this holy oil, he was able to make the sign of the cross on the forehead of the Frankish leader, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. In Gregory's text, we read that the king confessed all-powerful God in the Trinity. These innocuous words conceal an important medieval dispute, the internecine struggle between two different Christian beliefs, classical Catholics against the followers of Arianism, which the Catholic Church regarded as heretical. It was a power struggle in which the Burgundians again played an important role. The history of France starts here. According to the standard cliché, the freshly arrived barbarians did all they could to distinguish themselves from the local population. But what happened to the Burgundians is a good example of the opposite, and from it we can extrapolate what it was like throughout Western Europe. In any event, Gundobad did everything he could to eliminate the tense relationship between the Arian Burgundians, mainly aristocrats and soldiers, and the Catholic Gallo-Romans, the vast majority of the population. Christianity didn't really take off until Emperor Constantine passed an edict in 313 in which the teachings of Jesus were officially tolerated and the persecution of Christians gradually came to an end. At the end of the 4th century, Emperor Theodosius went even further by prohibiting all other religions, and Christianity became the de facto religion of the state. By the early 5th century, half the Roman population consisted of Christians. That growth was stimulated not only by the enthusiastic commitment of the emperor and the bishop of Rome, the pope, but also by the growing riches of the church. The ecclesiastical authorities were only too glad to receive gifts from well-to-do aristocrats and citizens, who thereby hoped to secure their salvation. The faith thrived on the despair of the serfs and the riches of the aristocracy, like nettles and roses on a dung heap. Not only did the followers of Christ come down firmly in their choice of Latin as the language of their cult, but their dioceses also adopted the late classical management structure, which benefited the spread and organization of early Christianity. The local establishment of the church progressed smoothly, because the church had been clever enough to retain pagan shrines and convert them into Christian places of prayer. Monasteries began sprouting up here and there, a phenomenon that developed when the first ascetic hermits decided to give up their solitude and embrace community life. In these institutions, the monks kept classical culture alive thanks to their practice of teaching and copying manuscripts. Latin culture could have been entirely obliterated in the chaos of the migration of peoples, but partly thanks to the church, the influence of Roman civilization would continue to make itself felt in the prevailing administrative language, liturgy, teaching, and visual arts. The seeds of the great classical resurgence were sown in the early Middle Ages. By installing themselves in the still powerful structures of the Roman Empire, feeding upon the spiritual inspiration of church fathers like Augustine, systematically winning over the allegiance of the barbarians, and thanks in no small part to their culture of hard-working synods and councils, The Christians succeeded in creating an inspiring administrative homogeneity. Probably the most dangerous problem the church had to deal with in that early period was that of heretics, people who espoused heterodox doctrines. One of the most important of these was Arianism, the teachings of Arius, a 3rd-century Egyptian priest. He opposed the idea that the unique God of Christianity consisted of three equal manifestations, the Father, the Son, Christ, and the Holy Spirit, in which Jesus was the only one to possess both a divine and a human nature. Arius argued that Jesus was subordinate to the Father, having been begotten by him, so he could not have a divine nature, while others professed that Jesus, the Father, and the Holy Spirit were equals. This debate almost brought about a schism in the Church. Who was right, the Catholic Trinitarians, three equal persons, or the staunch Arians, Christ subordinate to the Father? During the Council of Nicaea of 325, not only did the ecclesiastical officials decide what day Easter should fall on for the rest of eternity, but they also declared once and for all what Orthodox teaching was, thereby branding the followers of Arius as heretics. It took a long time for that message to reach all the remote corners of Christendom. In the meantime, the Arian bishop Wulfila converted the Goths, which meant that the heresy was actually gaining followers. It was probably through the Goths that Arianism spread to the other barbarians of the East. The Burgundians had already converted during their Worms period, so they were heretics by definition when they landed in the valley of the Rhone and the Saone. In order to integrate into Gaul successfully, there was little the Franks and Burgundians could do except join the Christianity of the Gallo-Romans. Gundobad himself equivocated for years when it came to converting, but he remained an Arian. He opted for a policy of tolerance and a gradual transition from one religion to the other. His wife, Caritini, was a Catholic, like Clotilde, and was given permission to build a large church in Lyon. The king even allowed Bishop Avitus of Vienne to dedicate an openly critical treatise on Arianism to him. This Avitus succeeded in convincing Gundobad's son Sigismund to convert only a few months before Clovis's baptism in 506. Because Sigismund was already a Christian, albeit of the wrong sort, he, unlike the Frankish leader, was spared a dip in cold water and had to make do with a simple laying on of hands. Thus, the first Germanic leader to be received into the Catholic Church was a proper Burgundian king. This event quite probably hastened Clovis's religious turnaround. Clovis and Sigismund were still well and truly converted when they left together for the war against the Visigoths, who ruled over an enormous kingdom that extended from the Loire to Andalusia. I take it very hard that these Arians hold part of the Gauls, the brand new ex-pagan Clovis piously exclaimed. Let us go with God's help and conquer them, and bring the land under our control. Sigismund didn't have to be told twice. What made this Frankish-Burgundian crusade against the heretical Arians a remarkable undertaking was that Sigismund's father was still a follower of that particular version of Christianity. Once again, and not for the last time, religion was a pretext for accumulating power, riches, and territory. Not far from Poitiers, in the village of Vouillé to be precise, the Burgundian Frankish forces stumbled upon the army of the Visigoth king Alaric II. The battle had been raging for about a day when Clovis suddenly came upon Alaric, and without hesitation he struck him with his battle axe. Just then, two strapping Goths jumped on the Frankish king. He managed to escape by hiding behind his shield and jerking sharply on his horse's reins, while Alaric, dead as a doornail, toppled off his grey stallion. After the death of their leader, the Visigoths fled to the Iberian Peninsula, where their kingdom held out for two more centuries before the Moors destroyed it. The news that the leader of that powerful barbarian tribe had been killed in battle, and by none other than Clovis, stunned half the continent and lent even more lustre to the Frankish victory. By the spring of 507, Clovis had occupied practically all of Gaul, with the exception of Burgundy and Provence. This makes it easier to understand why, at the end of the 20th century, the inhabitants of Vouillet unveiled a commemorative plate with the somewhat bombastic but not entirely inaccurate words, "The history of France starts here." In Latin texts, Clodovig, as he was actually known, appeared as Clodovicus. The Germans call him Clodvig, Ludwig, Lodewijk, and the French, like the Dutch, the Belgians and the English, refer to him as Clovis, the tribal name for Louis. Clodovig is made up of the Germanic roots Hlod, fame, and Vig, combat, and accordingly is taken to mean illustrious in battle. Not only does his name summarise his career, but it also points the way to the French royal house, with its many kings named Louis. His aura of Frenchness only really began blazing at the end of his life, when the Frankish leader left the old capital of Tournai and chose Paris as the centre of his empire. Encouraged by his wife Clotilde, he had a great church built, so that his life, which was characterised by bloodshed, ended in a semblance of peaceful piety. The king and his wife were interred in their church in 511 and 545 respectively. Today that place is graced by the Pantheon, where France buries its national heroes with all due ceremonial. French grandeur literally has its roots in a Frankish Burgundian substratum. A napkin was placed under his neck. Whether by coincidence or not, the name Burgundia first cropped up in 506, the year of Sigismund's reception into the Catholic Church. When even the region's inhabitants began using this designation, local scholars decided it was time to start searching for a historic breeding ground. So they gathered stories of ancient saints who had died Catholic martyrs' deaths 300 or 400 years earlier in what was not yet called Burgundia, and combined them to form a kind of national creation myth. The resulting Burgundian cycle presented a picture of Burgundy as a chosen land, with pious, Christianizing heroes like Benignus of Dijon and Symphorianus of Autun. Suddenly, the Burgundian kingdom, whose history had started less than 100 years before, was shown to have existed for centuries. In 516, Gundobad died, opening the way for his son Sigismund to let his subjects join the ranks of the Orthodox Catholic peoples. Straight away, he built a cathedral in Geneva and asked the Pope for a vast number of relics. Without batting an eye, the Pope paid for the expansion of the Roman Catholic Church with a portion of holy remains, which were becoming increasingly minuscule the more they were divided and subdivided. The inexhaustible supply of Christian fossils and debris lent a lustre of holiness to the new churches. Sigismund seemed to be on a winning streak. The Alemanni had been subjugated, the Visigoths driven out, and a strong link had been forged with the Franks. Yet within a short time, the solid Burgundian Empire collapsed like a house of cards. After the death of his wife Ostrogotho, a daughter of the Ostrogoth king Theodoric the Great, as her name suggests, Sigismund remarried. This time it was to a charming servant of the queen, to the great irritation of his son Sigeric. One day Sigeric noticed his stepmother dressed in the clothes of his deceased mother and striding through the halls of the palace. That was all the adolescent needed to bring his frustration to boiling point. "You are not worthy to have on your back those garments which are known to have belonged to your mistress, that is, my mother," he shouted angrily. Insulted, the new wife complained to Sigismund. She blew the whole story into a conspiracy theory. His son was planning to overthrow him. The unstable Sigismund could not tolerate such a threat, and he had Sigeric killed during his afternoon nap. And while he slept, a napkin was placed under his neck and tied under his chin, and he was strangled by two servants who drew in opposite directions, according to the account, quite sober for him, by Gregory of Tours. That same evening, Sigismund had a change of heart and was racked with remorse. The broken king sought solace in the monastery of Saint-Maurice, which he had founded in 515. There, 9 teams of single-minded monks took turns singing psalms and canticles, one after another, day and night, an Eastern monastic tradition that entered the West via ancient Burgundy. The monks kept up their remarkable religious fervour until the beginning of the 9th century, good for almost 2.5 million hours of sung devotion. Sigismund's deep distress and swift repentance, and his devotion to the Catholic faith, later earned him a saint's halo. Pious criminals honoured the unfortunate monarch as the patron saint of repentant murderers. In 1365, his skull and battle axe were sent to Prague at the request of the Holy Roman Emperor Charles IV, who was ill at the time and was promptly healed, elevating the Burgundian Sigismund to the patron saint of the Bohemians. But that triumph was posthumous. In 522, his situation was worrisome. As Burgundy looked nervously towards the Italy of the Ostrogoths, where Theodoric the Great was ready to take up arms and avenge the death of his grandson, Clovis's son Clodomer did something that surprised both friend and foe alike. This Frankish leader had let himself be egged on by his Burgundian wife, Gundioca, the now-grown granddaughter of the Godegisel who had been beheaded 22 years earlier. For her, the hour of retribution had arrived. Traditionally, it was the duty of Germanic women to defend the family honour, and Gundioca demanded satisfaction for the murder of her parents and grandparents, all of them killed by King Gundobad. Gundobad himself was dead, but his son Sigismund, who had been weakened by these events, was the ideal victim for her vengeance. In 523, the army of the Franks crushed the demoralised Burgundian warriors of Sigismund, who himself managed a narrow escape. He fled to his monastery, but was intercepted in sight of the gate. Just as the rules of the Germanic Faihitha prescribed, Clodomer killed him and his relatives in exactly the same way that Sigismund's father, Gundobad, had put Godegisel and his family to death, first by beheading them, then throwing their remains down a deep well. Now that Gundobad's carefully wrought plans seemed doomed to go up in smoke, the Burgundians hurriedly crowned Sigismund's brother Gundomar as their new king. Surprisingly, Gundomar went on to give the Franks a drubbing 1 year later. Clodomer's head ended up on a spike, and Burgundy was once again alive and kicking. But this was no more than the last gasp for the royal house. In 534, the Merovingians crushed the Burgundian army once and for all, even though Gundomar managed to escape in the nick of time. He went into hiding and lived for years as a commoner in his own realm, which managed to preserve its identity even though it was now under the Frankish flag. The Franks lived in an almost perpetual state of war. Because every male descendant had an equal right to the property of the head of the family, royal families tended to fight over every morsel of land. The kinsmen of the late lamented Clodomer murdered his sons to avoid conceding any more territory to the Frankish Burgundian branch. This attempt to purify the Frankish royal family of Burgundian blood was pointless from the start, for the simple reason that it would require the elimination of practically everyone, including the killers themselves. To understand the problem, all we have to do is climb up into Clovis's family tree. It may be tough going, but there's a minor revelation at the end. It's all contained in the following, which admittedly sounds like a Merovingian melodrama. Clovis married Gundobad's niece Clotilde, and their son Clodomer had children with Gundioca, the granddaughter of Godegisel. After the death of Clodomer, Gundioca was simply passed on to Clovis's third son, the notorious Clotharius. In addition to Clovis's oldest son, Theuderic, who, like his father, had bedded a Burgundian princess the second time round, Suavegotha, daughter of Sigismund, and, with the exception of Theuderic's first son, Theudebert, child of the first marital union, all of Clovis's offspring had Burgundian blood flowing through their veins. Since Theudebert's branch consisted of only one son and one childless grandson, the non-Burgundian line quickly fizzled out. Consequently, the various genealogical twists and turns all point to one undeniable historical truth. The descendants of Clovis were as Burgundian as they were Frankish. This may explain why the Lex Burgundionum remained applicable until well into the 9th century, and why, with the exception of a few rare Franks, most bishops, landowners and aristocrats could pride themselves on their Burgundian origins. The famous statute book had set a successful integration policy in motion, which in turn ensured that the population would continue to identify as genuine Burgundians. The mythical kingdom might dissolve in the mists of time, but the name of Burgundy would defy the centuries. Behold the veil of the Virgil of the Lord. The Merovingian kingdom soon split into three large sections. Austrasia, whose capital was Reims, then Metz, Neustria, whose capital was Soissons, and Burgundy, whose capital was Chalon-sur-Saône. After two or three centuries, the Merovingians lost their effective power and languished in idleness like bloated kings, while their major domos, who took responsibility for all practical matters, gradually emerged as the real Frankish leaders. Under the feeble descendants of Clovis, the history of Burgundy plodded along, until foreign invasions caused the somewhat sluggish wheel of history to turn once again. By around 700, the Moors had conquered most of North Africa and ventured a successful crossing to the north, into Spain. In 711, they wiped the Visigoths off the map, and 8 years later they invaded the land on the other side of the Pyrenees, where they immediately took Narbonne. The unstoppable Arabic leader Abd al-Rahman plundered the entire region. This new influx of foreigners threatened to gobble up all the main pillars of the previous migrations one by one. One major domo from the Meuse region would call a halt to the Arab invasion. Pictorial depictions of this early medieval hero are all quite similar. They show a Frankish leader fearlessly gazing into the distance, a band wrapped round his long hair, a shaggy walrus moustache beneath an oversized snout, his hauberk stretched tightly across his chest, shield at his feet. The most salient detail is the bloody battle axe in his right hand. Charles Martel is invariably depicted as the most valiant warrior of his time. Martel's plan was to use the Moors' invasions to gain control of the fragmented territories of the Merovingians. In October 732, he and his warriors marched into the valley of the Clain, north of today's Poitiers. For the first time since their arrival on European soil, the Arabs were facing a disciplined military force that was armed to the teeth. It was the horsemen of Islam against Christian shock troops, Abd al-Rahman versus Charles Martel. As in the time of Aetius and Attila, the Burgundians formed an important division of the Allied forces. At first, the Frankish elite contingent held back, letting the infantry fight the initial battle. Their many bodies, disemboweled and beheaded, covered the swampy, muddy ground. It was on that ghastly carpet that the battle was decided. Charles Martel fought like a madman, swinging his battle axe like a hammer, Martellus in Latin. From the clash of two opposing cultures hacking away at each other, his name would illuminate the age after which he was named, the Carolingian. The Allies took heart, the Moors lost ground. Their army was more suited to large-scale raids than to a classical test of strength. When Abd al-Rahman was finally killed, his troops fled in panic. In his report of the battle, one chronicler accomplished two remarkable feats in one. Not only did he enrich the annals with his unforgettable name, Notke the Stammerer, but he also described the motley coalition of Christian troops as Europenses. For the first time, the word Europeans flowed from a chronicler's pen. During the whole Carolingian period, Burgundy was absorbed quasi-anonymously into the kingdom of Martel's grandson Charlemagne, and the old name was in danger of disappearing altogether. Only after the division of Charlemagne's empire in the Treaty of Verdun in 843 did the term Burgundia reappear in the writings of the chroniclers. Charlemagne's immense kingdom was divided into three parts: West Francia, the area that would later come to be known as France; East Francia, the region that would develop into Germany, a Catholic kingdom next to an equally Catholic empire; and Middle Francia between them, which ran from Friesland to Italy, but after a few decades became part of the Eastern Empire. In the division of Charlemagne's lands, old Burgundy was split down the middle. The eastern part soon separated from the Holy Roman Empire and began calling itself the Free County of Burgundy. The explicit reference to the old kingdom gradually disappeared, and in time this region would simply be called the Franche-Comté, the Free County, as it is today. Gradually, the name Burgundy came to be used for the western part alone, which had been ceded to West Francia, roughly the area between Nevers, Dijon, and Mâcon. As if enough blood hadn't already been shed in the fiercely fought partitioning of the Carolingian kingdom, the Germanic and Arabic invasion of Europe was followed by the lightning incursions of Scandinavian warriors. At the end of the 9th century, the Vikings snaked their way down the twists and turns of the Seine, the Loire, the Yonne, and the Aube, and deep into Burgundy, plundering the rich monasteries of the region as they went. The Count of Autun, a man named Richard, accepted the challenge to defend the threatened region. Richard was so effective in kicking the Vikings out of Burgundy that he soon became known as the Justiciar. When word of his success spread, a great many monks left the northeastern part of the kingdom and brought their relics to the relative safety of Burgundy, where new monasteries shot up like toadstools. Richard may have pushed the Vikings back to the valley of the Seine, but that did little to make them less menacing. To say that the Viking leader Rollo and his troops made West Francia unsafe is an understatement. In 911, he set his sights on Chartres. As the siege went on, the town didn't seem to stand a chance, but suddenly a miracle occurred. The Bishop of Chartres, Ganselm, appeared in a diamond-encrusted chasuble. He knew that this was his moment, and he didn't hesitate. He dropped his crozier, thrust out his chest, tore his upper garment, and pulled out a piece of cloth, which was immediately lit by a ray of sunlight from heaven. Then he cried out ecstatically, "Behold the tunic of the Virgin of the Lord!" The garment that Mary had worn while giving birth to Jesus, according to tradition, must have worked like a kind of military aphrodisiac, for the heretical Norseman Rollo was mercilessly thrashed, and by treaty was banished to a region that came to be known as Normandy because of his presence. There he would remain, consent to be baptized, and go on to defend France against the incursion of other Norsemen. 150 years later, his great-great-great-grandson William would invade England from that very spot, and would thereafter bear the epithet the Conqueror. The legend of Rollo's defeat is pleasant enough to read. The tunic of the Virgin is still preserved in the cathedral at Chartres, but the reality was a bit more prosaic. Ganselm had undoubtedly roused his troops with his flair for the theatrical gesture, but it was mainly the timely arrival of Richard the Justiciar once again that brought the Vikings down. After a siege lasting 100 days, the Burgundian count liberated the town in July. The conclusion is as brief as it is important: no Normandy without Burgundy. The man who performed so many feats of strength was given permission by the French king to style himself Duke. Richard chose Dijon as the capital of his duchy, which comprised only a modest part of Gundobad's legendary kingdom, but this does nothing to lessen its historic importance. Thanks to this victory over Scandinavian raiders, the seed of the illustrious Burgundian duchy took root at the beginning of the 10th century. From Burgundy to Flanders. Or how the emergence of the feudal system also influenced the evolution of the Burgundian duchy. How the church in the 11th and 12th centuries could just as well have been ruled from Burgundy as from Rome. But also how the plague and the Hundred Years' War were responsible for linking Flanders with Burgundy after 1369. Because the land was repeatedly partitioned among all the king's sons, the Carolingian kingdom eventually fell apart due to an unstoppable process of fragmentation. After a while, there was little territory left to partition. When Louis the Do-Nothing suffered a fatal fall from his horse in 987, the great lords of the kingdom were forced to choose a successor, and without delay. With his legendary penchant for dolce far niente, the deceased monarch had failed to leave any progeny. He would go down in history as the last Carolingian. The counts and dukes cast their eye on the unremarkable Hugo Capet, whose very weakness made him look attractive. The uglier the king, the freer their hands. Capet's domain consisted of little more than the snippet of land between Senlis and Orléans, the region around Paris. His governing strategy was anything but ambitious, although he was clever enough to establish the policy of passing on territory in its entirety to the oldest son. This simple but brilliant idea of the crown prince became the germ of his posthumous success. No one could have imagined that such a fragile king would be the first in a series of 36 monarchs. The Capetians would systematically enlarge their domain and occupy the French throne for 800 years. After 987, it became commonly accepted to speak of West Francia simply as France. The once lean family tree produced a single robust twig, whose foliage grew as far as Dijon and would cast its shadow over Burgundy for centuries to come. Capet's grandson Robert dreamed of toppling his older brother Henry I from the French throne, but in the end he had to content himself with Burgundy in 1032. The duchy was then passed down from father to son for the next 300 years. Duke Robert was the founding father of the Burgundian Capetians. In the 11th century, a close tie formed between the French crown and the region around Dijon, and the Duke of Burgundy became one of the most important authority figures in the kingdom after the king. While the French Capetians had great difficulty pulling their kingdom together, the Burgundian Capetians quietly gave shape to Burgundy. Slowly but surely, they prepared themselves for a spectacular advance. In the medieval feudal structure, the king occupied the top position. Beneath him were his vassals, who ruled a fiefdom in their sovereign's name, swore loyalty to him, and pledged military support. These vassals did the same with the lords beneath them, and in this manner the waterfall of power cascaded down to the very bottom, where peasants worked for a lord in exchange for protection from outside danger. Because the arm of Hugo Capet did not reach very far, the actual power in still young France lay with the counts and dukes of Aquitaine, Brittany, Normandy, Toulouse, Gascony, Anjou, Flanders, and Burgundy. But even in those regions, power was pulverized into smaller and smaller units due to the absence of a balanced central authority. During the raids of the Moors and the Vikings, local lords usually assumed the responsibility of defending their own villages, and walled fortresses were built. In these dark bastions, the local rural aristocracy imitated the king's royal household, but on a small scale. Peasants were treated like beasts, and in order to survive, they often had to sell everything, sometimes even themselves, to the local baron, who enriched himself on the backs of his toiling serfs. To keep them obedient and submissive, the nobility recruited heavily armed horsemen. The English would later call these hauberk-clad servants knights, a boost in status that would never come to resonate in the Dutch word knecht, which simply means servant or farmhand. The French word chevalier still retains the reference to horses and the fact that these knights were horsemen, as does the Dutch word for knight, ridder or rider. This unfair division was part of a world order so unshakable that no medieval person would even think of bringing it down. The bellatores, those who wage war, the oratores, those who pray, and the laboratores, those who work, formed a social structure that would hold firm roughly until the French Revolution. The churchmen prayed for everyone's salvation, the warriors fought on everyone's behalf, and the workers worked for the churchmen and the warriors. Not only was the system highly predictable, but so was daily reality. Hunger, war, and sickness were the refrains of the average medieval existence. Most men never made it past 30. This pitiful life expectancy was the result of a high infant mortality rate, a lack of nutritious food, and inadequate medical care. For women, 20 years of life was all they could hope for, since they began bearing children at around the age of 14 and often died in childbirth. Yet there were quite a few old people. Once you passed 20, you had a reasonably good chance of reaching a respectable age. Slowly but surely, the prestige of the praying folk began to rise, and early in the 11th century, the oratores made an attempt to curb the brutal rule of the aristocracy. By means of the so-called Peace of God movement, the church tried to erect a barrier against the waves of violence that were being stirred up by the local lords and knights. During heavily attended public ceremonies, knights would be required to take oaths, promising not to harass any women or children, clerics or pilgrims, travellers or merchants. In short, anyone who was not participating in wars and battles. Bishops would raise their croziers in the air, and immediately thousands of hands would go up. It was a monumental gesture towards heaven. "Peace, peace, peace," came the cry, as if from a single mouth. Even the most merciless lords were impressed by these people's counsels, and literally dropped to their knees on pain of excommunication, a ticket straight to hell. Yet these efforts didn't always bear fruit. By the end of the 11th century, the church decided to channel the violent excesses of feudalism in the direction of the Middle East, giving birth to the Crusades. Weren't the heretics there making life miserable for brothers in the faith? Wasn't it possible that they were defiling the grave of Christ? Weren't they even denying Christians entrance to the holy city of Jerusalem? While the knights were expected to guard against physical threats in a way that was just and fair, a growing army of monks assumed responsibility for pleading for the world's salvation before the throne of the Creator. Since the king, who had been anointed by the church, often failed to fulfill this role, these monks were obliged to take on the job of tempering God's wrath and begging for his mercy. Countless individuals turned their backs on the world and embarked on a life void of sensual pleasures or riches. Alms came pouring in. Poor wretches, as well as lords of the castle, were eager to secure as comfortable a place in the hereafter as they could afford. Monasteries had long served as the spiritual playthings of the regional nobility, but a major reform movement brought that to an end. A vast number of abbeys emerged as the most important power centres of the 11th century. A white cloak of churches. Not far from virgin forests, where rabbits, martens, wild boars, lynxes, and bears roamed free, if they hadn't already been slaughtered during the tedious hunting parties organised by local potentates, lay the idyllic village of Cluny, which, aside from its hunting lodge, wooden chapel, and a few shabby vineyards, had nothing to recommend it. This Burgundian hamlet, with its paradisiacal sweetness, was the ideal place to accommodate a new monastery. The hunters would have to satisfy their cravings elsewhere. The yelping of the hounds was replaced by the praying of monks. The new Benedictine abbey was consecrated on the 11th of September 910 as an independent institution. By the middle of the 11th century, it had grown into the centre of a religious network that numbered 1,500 monasteries, one of the first multinationals in history. Ora et labora, pray and work. Cluny bent the age-old rule of St. Benedict to its purposes. The accent shifted to the first aspect of the rule, and not slightly, but overwhelmingly. The monks may have had a symbolic encounter with a rake or a shovel, but it was serfs and tenant farmers who did most of the work. When it came to prayer and singing, however, they performed with gusto. As the Burgundian monk and chronicler Raoul Glaber wrote, "I myself am witness that in this monastery it is a custom that masses be celebrated constantly from the earliest hour of the day until the hour assigned for rest." At the height of their spiritual productivity, the brothers, who thank God could relieve each other owing to their sheer numbers, sang their way through 138 psalms in a single day, while St. Benedict was quite happy if the monks could get through 150 a week. "And they go about it with so much dignity and piety and veneration," Glaber continued, "that one would think they were angels rather than men." The monks of Cluny made it a point of honour to attend to the spiritual welfare of the dead. The order laid the basis for the celebration of All Souls' Day on the 2nd of November. An ever-expanding cemetery grew up around the monastery, an undertaking as lucrative as it was pious. To pray for the salvation of all mortals, living and dead, the monastic community, with hundreds of daughter houses throughout Europe, released a boundless stream of prayers to the Heavenly Father. Otherwise, an impressive silence reigned in the monastery, and monks were forced to communicate in sometimes unfathomable sign language. The sign for a woman was the same as that for a trout, an almost sensual stroking of the forehead with the index finger from one eyebrow to the other. The liturgical aesthetic was echoed in the increasingly beautiful design of Cluny's own Abbey Church. Three buildings followed each other in rapid succession, and the third remained the largest church in Europe until the construction of St. Peter's Basilica in Rome. Artistic creativity and monastic religious expression went hand in hand, and thanks to the international network of daughter houses and pilgrim churches in 11th century Burgundy, these cultural forms spread across the continent. Europe embraced Romanesque architecture with enthusiasm. Older church buildings, the ceilings and roofs of which were usually made of wood and easily caught fire, made way for larger places of worship, erected with massive stone walls and fitted with small windows. The pillars were connected by means of stone arches and ribbed vaults, thus allowing for larger interior spaces in which separate chapels could also be built. The success of the monastic life required more and more altars. For the first time, the exteriors of the churches were also ornamented, giving the facade in particular a most imposing vitality. As Glaber wrote, "It looked as though the very world was shaking itself to take off its old age and to reclothe itself in all areas in a white cloak of churches." It was mainly under the guidance of Abbot Hugo, who was elected in 1049 and led the order for 60 years, that Cluny made a name for itself and became known even in the far reaches of Portugal, Scotland, and Italy. Hugo's intelligence and authority reflected on the entire monastic community. After King Philip I of France was excommunicated for adultery in the autumn of his years, he began to worry about his spiritual welfare and requested permission to enter the monastery. His only condition was that he be allowed to keep his crown. But Hugo was adamant. Without distancing himself from worldly glory, there would be no room for his royal cousin at Cluny. When William the Conqueror asked him for monks to staff his English monasteries, the abbot refused, despite the handsome remuneration. And he did so because he feared his brothers would not be able to regulate their way of life in the same spirit of independence. It would easily take as long to pray a couple of rosaries as it would to list all of Hugo's international achievements. The illustrious abbot wore out several popes in his long career, and he always maintained a direct line with Rome. He accompanied Bruno Eggesheim, who had spent a night at Cluny as a pilgrim on his journey to the Vatican, and was present when Bruno donned the tiara for the first time as Leo IX. Pope Urban II was also steeped in the spirit of Cluny, and when he called for the First Crusade on the 18th of November 1095 during the Council of Clermont with the words Deo lo volt, God wills it, Hugo of Cluny stood approvingly at his side. Finally, Pope Paschal II, a former brother of the Mother House, also aligned his policy with the great abbot's favourite themes. Hugo's network supplied much-needed support for a thorough reformation of the Church. More than ever, celibacy for clerics and Christian marriage for the laity became two fundamental precepts. He also banned the sale of ecclesiastical offices, and laypeople were not allowed to interfere in religious affairs. The Peace of God movement, which first emerged in southern countries, only reached full bloom when Cluny agreed to support it. Soon, lords of the castle and knights from the northern Rhone Valley, Burgundy, the Franche-Comté, and even from the regions north of Paris, where the bloody tradition of the Faihitha had never gone out of fashion, agreed to comply with the imposed rules for peace. The Holy See was firmly grounded in the Ecclesia Cluniacensis. In fact, over the course of the 11th century, the Catholic Church was being governed from Burgundy as much as it was from Rome. But that didn't stop the great Hugo from searching for his bed of straw every night to humbly sleep among his monks. From 1100 on, the worldly success of the Benedictine order provoked growing criticism. Shouldn't the monks stick to their own affairs within the walls of their monasteries and leave the world to its own devices? Wasn't that how the Cluniac monks got started in the first place? Wasn't it the king's job to guarantee peace in his kingdom? Cluny's affluence and splendour also came under fire. Shouldn't modesty be a Catholic virtue? Could it be that the order had become far too rich? The strongest opposition came from Burgundy itself. In situ, scarcely 100 kilometres from Cluny, an abbey with even stricter observance was consecrated in 1098. Driven by Bernard of Clairvaux, a Burgundian born and bred, the Cistercian order would eventually unite more than 700 daughter houses within its fold. At a time when money and corruption were on the rise in church circles, the ascetic example of Citeaux exerted ever greater fascination. Soon the Catholic world found that it could follow two opposing paths, two ways that led from and to Burgundy. A religiosity moved by beauty, that was nourished by liturgical ceremony and dazzling churches, and a mystical passion that relied on the joys of poverty and asceticism. Cluny as opposed to Citeaux, Hugo versus Bernard. More than ever before, Burgundy of the 12th century had become the beating heart of the Respublica Christiana. Bernard, unlike the followers of the great Hugo, honoured not only the aura but also the labora of Benedict's rule. There were no serfs, as there were in Cluny. The Cistercian brothers themselves put their hands to the plough. There was something particularly Burgundian about this physical doggedness, however. In 1110, the monks planted the first grapevines on the stony subsoil of a nearby slope, and they did their utmost to create as beatific a drink as possible. Was there a more perfect counterpart to spiritual labour than to harvest the blood of Christ by the sweat of one's brow? The Cistercians continued to plant their vines until thousands of acres were put into service. Gradually they improved their production methods, which had made little progress since the arrival of the Romans. It was a labour-intensive enterprise, but wasn't time something that the monks had in abundance? They built a stone enclosure that served to defend their grapevines from the far too aggressive pigs, boars and deers. It also protected the early vines from the wind, and they thrived from the stored heat that the stones gave off at night. In 1212, this Clausum de Vougeot, the walled grove of Vougeot, was reported in a document named after the adjoining village. And perhaps the abstinence-loving St. Bernard once celebrated Mass with wine that would one day become the celebrated Grand Cru of Burgundy. Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this Clos de Vougeot is my blood, the blood of the new and everlasting covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. The Meursault and Clos de Tarr wines, renowned for both their name and their finish, also came to full maturity thanks to the daughter houses of Citeaux. The temptations of alcohol gave rise to the requisite moral dilemmas, and one of the monks once asked Bernard how the rule of St. Benedict could be reconciled with the love for Bacchus. "By not drinking more than one hemina a day," was the answer given by the spiritual leader. This ancient Roman measurement was the equivalent of 0.27 litres, one small carafe to get you through the day. In short, enough to modestly quench your thirst, but not enough to cause you to nod off during the intoning of the psalms. And, as an extra test of abstinence, the monks slept above the wine cellar at night. Despite the severity of Bernard, who refused the position of archbishop when it was offered him in order to stay on as abbot, the Order of Citeaux ended up following the same path as Cluny and became one of the wealthiest religious organisations in Europe. Their inspiring power shrank as their treasuries filled and their administrative ambitions grew. The affluent Cistercians were a contradiction in terms. Few of their abbots were inclined to reject the bishop's mitre, and they built magnificent Gothic cathedrals that were a far cry from the sober, modest edifices their order had once so fervently promoted. "Beware, Father, to the left! Beware, Father, to the right!" To a great extent, the Order of Citeaux owed its very existence to Odo I of Burgundy. In 1098, the Duke not only donated the land on which the abbey would be erected, but he also financed its construction. 3 years later, the courageous and godly Odo took part in a final offshoot of the First Crusade. He died before reaching Jerusalem. The mortal remains of the worldly founder of Citeaux were buried in the shadow of his abbey. For the next 250 years, all the Burgundian dukes would find their final resting place there, and all but three of them were named Odo or Hugo. The prestige of the two mother houses outshone the dukes in life as well as in death, which had its advantages. Safe within that shelter, the dukes could work on steadily strengthening their central authority in Dijon. Compared with the spectacular advances of the French Capetians, who had retaken a large part of the former West Francia, the inheritance of their Burgundian relations looked much less impressive. But by taking advantage of the international appeal of Cluny and Citeaux, they succeeded in breathing new life into the Burgundian sense of unity. The dukes achieved on a small scale what Gundobad had brought about on a larger one. Because of its position on the border, the duchy was given the task of defending the kingdom, which strengthened its tie with the French crown. That assignment seasoned the early Burgundian consciousness with a pinch of French nationalism. But danger was lurking as well, not from across the nearby border with the Holy Roman Empire, but from the other side of the Channel, where William the Conqueror and his descendants had been ruling since 1066. Henry Plantagenet, great-grandson of William and future King of England, married the clever and ravishingly beautiful Eleanor of Aquitaine in 1152. Scarcely 8 weeks earlier, she had been divorced from King Louis VII of France, with whom she had led a contentious married life for 15 years. With relief, she traded one crown for another, and overnight the great Aquitaine, the entire southwestern region of the kingdom, fell into the hands of the English crown. The tempestuous Henry, who was also Duke of Normandy thanks to his great-grandfather and Count of Anjou through his father, was suddenly the most powerful vassal of the French king. That situation led to friction between the superpowers, which at the beginning of the 14th century would result in one of the bloodiest conflicts in Western history, when periods of ceasefire would alternate with savage raids, invasions, and epic battles. The conflict lasted so long that, for the sake of convenience, historians began calling the 116 years of misery the Hundred Years' War. In 1314, the French king, Philip the Fair, gave up the ghost. He left three sons, all of whom failed to produce heirs to the throne, and to make matters worse, they all died young. Louis the Quarrelsome, Philip the Tall, and Charles the Fair managed to occupy the throne for less than 14 years altogether. The reign of the baby king, John the Posthumous, a mere 5 days, failed to resolve the problem. The stock of successors was exhausted, and a legitimate king had to be found without delay. Actually, the sister of the three late lamented monarchs, Isabella, could have claimed the throne, but the French found that idea very hard to swallow, since she was the widow of the recently deceased English king, Edward II. His son, Edward III, was barely 15, and too weak to stand up to the French legal scholars, who were busy digging up apocryphal documents in order to prohibit succession via the female line. Now that the direct descendants of Hugo Capet had died off, the throne went to a cadet branch, an offshoot of a brother of Philip the Fair. 10 years later, the new House of Valois, of which the Capetians were members, but which bore the name of their specific family branch, was forced to deal with the ambitions of Edward III, now age 25. On the 19th of October 1337, he declared war on France and launched his long military escapade. From a purely genealogical standpoint, Edward was in the right. Denying the throne on the basis of succession through the female line was nonsense, and as a grandson of Philip the Fair, he was among the first in line, unlike the scions of the Valois cadet branch. In addition, he knew quite well what he was fighting for, the tempting prize of having an English king also sitting on the French throne. In 1346, he crossed the Channel and pulverized the French for the first time near Crécy in Picardy. Then he began the siege of Calais that would drag on for a full year. The situation was hopeless. 6 citizens, with nooses round their necks and the keys to the city in their hands, approached Edward III at a ponderous, shuffling gait to offer their lives if he would spare the town. Moved by this gesture, the English queen, Philippa of Hainaut, succeeded in convincing her husband to undertake an act of clemency, a romantic footnote in a sordid story. Auguste Rodin would depict the poignant scene in bronze half a millennium later. From then on, English troops had safe access to French soil at the port of Calais. With the fall of this strategic stronghold, the richest land in Europe stumbled into the darkest century of its history. 3 years later, Philip VI died, the first Valois king, and it was up to John the Good to defend France's honour. Why his countrymen called him the Good is a mystery, since under his leadership the country went into a total decline. In an effort to breathe new life into the old knightly ideals, John founded the Order of the Star. When the lords gathered together, it wasn't just to brag about their heroic deeds. They also swore never to flee more than 600 metres from a battlefield, and to die or be taken prisoner rather than abandon their king. Such breathless valour would prove fatal to the French on more than one occasion. In 1356, the English launched countless raids from Aquitaine. Now that the enemy was approaching the heart of France, the French king's call to mobilise met with a huge positive response. "No knight and no squire remained at home," the chroniclers wrote. The king was so certain of victory that he even conscripted his 4 sons to fight. After a long pursuit, the French army came upon the enemy in the environs of Poitiers. On the 19th of September 1356, the king was given what he had so longed for, a second chance to make up for the defeat his father had suffered 10 years earlier at Crécy. There they were, John the Good against the Prince of Wales. The French king, whose one desire was to become the greatest knight of his age, against the eldest son of Edward III, who wore a black cape over his armour, Le Bon versus the Black Prince. The English had chosen an ideal spot on high ground, which could only be reached by way of a road so thickly lined with hedges that even four adjacent riders had difficulty ascending it. This didn't keep the French king from throwing his principal forces into the fray. Blinded by the overconfidence he gleaned from ancient tales, the king sent his best horsemen up the hill, even though he could just as well have chosen to starve the enemy into submission. But such a cowardly approach would have run counter to every ideal of chivalry. A hail of English arrows descended on the cavalry and their horses, who tumbled over each other, collapsing and snorting. The horses that survived did an about turn, and wild with panic, charged at the French ground troops. Suddenly, John the Good realized what an exercise in folly it had been to send in all his sons. He quickly ordered the Dauphin Charles and his two brothers to leave the battlefield in order to safeguard the line of succession. His youngest and his favourite, the 14-year-old Philip, remained at his side. The departure of the three princes looked so much like desertion that a large portion of the army decided to abandon the king. The 7,000 Englishmen, who had faced twice as many of the enemy when the battle began, suddenly took heart. John himself refused to leave. He insisted on defending his honour. "Advance," he cried, "for I will recover the day or die on the field." Fully aware that no cuirass would offer him better protection, John pulled over his armour a blue mantle embroidered with golden lilies, the symbol of the French monarchy. The enemy, who could thus easily recognise him, would do everything they could to take him alive and then demand an outrageously high ransom for him. When the English identified John the Good fighting in the melee, they rushed towards him. But the king wasn't going to give up that easily. Hacking away like a wild man at everyone around him, he seemed to have forgotten that he was clothed in fleur-de-lis. In fact, he gave the distinct impression that he wanted to keep on fighting until his dying breath. Teeth were being broken, arms chopped off, entrails spilling from opened bellies. The group around the French king was shrinking by the minute. "Where to the left?" shouted his son Philip, who was just able to block a sword's thrust. His father, one of the most feared old warriors in Europe, cut a path to the left despite the fact that his helmet had been knocked off. "Beware, father, to the right!" screamed his son, and swinging his battle axe, John eliminated another approaching Englishman.
"Yield, yield, or you are a dead man," someone shouted at the king.
It was Denis of Morbic, a French-speaking nobleman from Flanders who had been banished to England for murder and was now serving in the army of the Black Prince.
"Yield yourself to me, and I will lead you to the Prince of Wales."
Exhausted and helmetless, John the Good handed his right glove to the nobleman from Morbihan. His blue mantle was torn, the fleur-de-lis drenched in blood. Philip followed his father's example. As at Crécy, the strongest army of knights in Europe had bitten the dust. Even Francesco Petrarch, the poet and founder of humanism, who heard the news in Milan, could hardly believe it. The French had been undone by two major mistakes. Their troops still swore by the crossbow, admittedly robust but difficult to operate, while the English longbow was capable of shooting 12 arrows a minute, covering a distance of 300 metres and striking with devastating force. In addition, the French noblemen looked down on the infantry and preferred to fill their ranks with swaggering, drunken knights on horseback. The English weren't the least bit bothered by fighting alongside ordinary commoners who were skilled with the longbow, and they even put a premium on seamless cooperation between horsemen and archers. In French history, the Battle of Poitiers has the ring of a heroic thunderclap, a high point of military and national glory. Charles Martel beating the Moors and saving the country from the threat of an Arabic takeover. Not only was the actual situation a lot more nuanced, but patriotic historians kept cranking up the glory in order to divert attention from that other doomed Battle of Poitiers. In the annals of French history, the 25th of October 732 has been successfully used to erase the blighted 19th of September 1356. Anyone who evokes Poitiers today automatically thinks of Charles Martel, but not a living soul knows who John the Good was. In the autumn of 1356, the deeply humiliated France had to find something to lean on, so the cry, "Beware father to the left, beware father to the right," became a heroic refrain that could be heard in every corner of the country. It provided the king's youngest son, Philip, with a nickname that the kingdom found warmly consoling, Le Hardi, the bold, the brave, an epithet en ornans that rang like a bell, a title of honour that would guarantee Philip the Bold a place in the history books. But the consequences of his bravado at Poitiers were especially important for the future of Burgundy. Voluntarily risked death. After having descended into the snake pit of the Hundred Years' War in the 1330s, France was forced to deal with one of the cruelest invasions in its history. At the beginning of 1348, the plague entered the country by way of Marseille. By the summer, the bacilli had already overrun the capital. Half the population of Paris was mowed down, and then the epidemic swept northward. In Flanders, it was called the hastige ziekte, the hasty disease, or simply gadot, sudden death. Burgundy too was devastated. In the village of Rully, only 10 families survived. In Givry, with a population of just under 1,500 souls, 615 villagers died within 14 weeks. In the town of Paray-le-Monial, a mere 12% escaped the grim reaper. And in Nuit-Saint-Georges, this saying was making the rounds. En 1348, à nuit sur 100 restèrent 8. The phrase 8 out of 100 survived may have been a bit of an exaggeration for the sake of the rhyme, but the famous chronicler Jean Froissart estimated that a third of the world perished. This alarming figure would later be confirmed by historians. While the plague raged more fiercely among the poor, the rich were not spared either. The Burgundian Duke Odo IV was not the only one to succumb to the contagious disease in 1349. John the Good, then still the Crown Prince, lost his wife and his mother. His father, King Philip VI, ordered the medical faculty of Paris University to figure out where the infernal plague was coming from. The scientists pointed to the peculiar position of the planets, but most mortals firmly believed that the cause of the terrible malady was to be sought much further afield. What else could unleash a plague of such biblical proportions than the wrath of God? Half-naked penitents began appearing in the streets. The best they could come up with was to drive out sin by flogging themselves with iron-tipped scourges, an exercise that provided very little relief to tormented humanity. A scapegoat, some thought, would be more effective. All fingers pointed in the same direction. Jews were accused of poisoning fountains and wells, and in Antwerp, Brussels, Basel, Strasbourg, Frankfurt, Cologne, Narbonne, Chinon, but also in the Burgundian city of Beaune, they were simply murdered or harshly driven out. The fact that they, too, were dying of the plague in droves was beside the point. After the Black Death had gone on its mad rampage, a process that took only a few days and involved pain in the chest, blood welling up in the throat, abscesses full of pus on arms and thighs, black spots on the skin, death agonies, it also made short work of common sense. Rats and fleas were such familiar companions that no one gave even half a moment's thought to the possibility that they might be the plague's carriers. To make matters worse, after the retreat of the army of plague bacilli, France was doomed to suffer the disaster of Poitiers in 1356. While King John the Good, now under lock and key in London, remained convinced that he had done his duty, riots broke out in France that drove the country to the brink of civil war. For the cunning Edward III, this was the signal that it was time to resurrect his claim to the French crown. In the autumn of 1359, he had 12,000 troops shipped to the harbour of Calais. After the double fiasco of Crécy and Poitiers, the French refused to plunge into another reckless adventure. Everywhere they went, the English encountered closed city gates. Not a single army was willing to take them on. When the city of Reims appeared impregnable, the peevish Edward decided to establish winter quarters in Burgundy. For the local inhabitants, the devastating raids throughout the duchy were their first real experience of the misery of war with England. The 16-year-old Burgundian Duke Philip of Rouvre, not to be confused with Philip the Bold, the king's son, was named after the castle in which he normally resided. He was glad to be able to conclude a 3-year truce with Edward on the 10th of March, 1360. The English king left Burgundy, but he found Paris a hard nut to crack. He cursed the French, who just didn't want to fight. The futile, phony war so affected his resolve that when a hellish hailstorm put his exhausted army to the test, Edward said he was ready to talk peace. On the 8th of May, 1360, in the castle of Bretigny, not far from the place where Richard of Burgundy had crushed Edward's ancestor Rollo, a treaty was signed that gave the French a costly ceasefire. Edward acquired Aquitaine and Calais once and for all, giving him a third of the French kingdom, and in return he renounced his claim to the French throne. The French also had to cough up a fantastic sum of 3 million écus to purchase their king's freedom. In expectation of payment, John the Good was able to return to Paris, and his sons Louis and John took his place. One of the first orders of business undertaken by the released king was the horse trading of his 11-year-old daughter Isabella, who was transferred to Milan to marry the immensely rich Galeazzo Visconti for the record amount of 600,000 gold florins. John must have breathed a sigh of relief. But the consequences of the treaty were catastrophic for the French population. The English soldiers and German mercenaries who were discharged from military service by Edward III did not all return to their homelands. A large number of them formed gangs, and for good measure they took on board a number of frustrated French knights who had been ruined by the high taxes. Like wasps roughly evicted from their nest, they swept across the countryside. The war had been going on for more than 20 years, and morals had not improved during that period. Wandering brigands organised themselves into self-sustaining companies, whose ranks included not only bakers and butchers, but also bankers and prostitutes. The mainly agrarian Burgundy, with its flourishing wine culture, was one of the regions most infested by bandits and mercenaries. Going on a journey without an armed escort became a suicidal venture. One of the jobs of the Duke was to stamp out these routiers, highwaymen, but Philip of Rouvre had something else to occupy his mind. While
roaming... We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.